Welcome to Brothers Build, a show dedicated to discussing and constructing solutions from the voice of men in the community. You are now watching Brothers Build.
Welcome to this second edition of Brothers Build. Brothers Build is a think tank and a conversation with black men in the community where we discuss issues, concerns, reviews, and just ideas to build the intellectual think tank of our community. On this edition, we are going to be discussing the Sandra Bland incident that happened amongst our community. We're going to talk about the Justice or Else March that's happening in 2 months. And we're also going to close out with a review to talk about the critically acclaimed Straight Outta Compton movie. And there's going to be a variety of different perspectives and conversations that's going to come out of this. So again, our goal is to build thought, ideas, and intellect amongst our community. I'm sitting here with my brother to the left.
Hello, Timmy Lahino Lasagna, glad to be here.
Brother Antonio Muhammad from the Nation of Islam.
Andrew Lemmy.
In our next segment, we're going to be joined by two other brothers also in Brothers Build. So right now, we're going to go ahead and get started and talk about this Sandra Bland situation. A situation where a sister was stopped in Waller County, Texas, and stopped by a Texas Ranger and pulled over for a traffic violation, end up in jail within 12 hours, and then a couple of days later, she loses her life. So let's talk about that real quick. Who wants to start it off.
Okay. I think it's indicative of the police behavior with our people, really in the history of this country, but more recently than that, it's taken an even more evil, despicable route. I really feel like it's almost like there's a whole idea behind the surface of just inbreeding fear in our people. Because even though other people are having issues with police officers, it really seems to me as if we're being targeted. And it started off to me being in the forefront with the Trayvon Martin case 2 or 3 years ago, and it seemed to be targeted mainly at young black men. But now black people in general, to me, appear to be unsafe in this country at routine traffic stops.
That's right. So it definitely seemed like state authority has a targeted purpose or a targeted agenda, if you want to say, to violate the civil liberties of African-American people, not just black men, but now we're seeing black women. My brothers want to chime in on this.
Well, I mean, I think that, like Brother O just mentioned, this isn't anything new. We're not faced with anything new or strange here in recent times. I think now we live in an age where everything is recorded, everything happens instantaneously. So now we have an opportunity to hear about these things much faster than probably, you know, 10 or 15 years ago. I'm not sure, I've never seen any numbers per se that says that this is happening at a more rapid pace than normal. I would like to see something like that.
That's right.
So that we can have that evidence. But I think it's definitely something that we need to start talking more about and start talking about solutions and things that we can do to secure our community, secure our women, our children, and start from an internal perspective of the things that we can do first before we can even get to some of those outside of the community things that we need to tackle, if that makes sense.
That's right, it makes perfect sense. So again, we see this as a trend that's happened to the African-American community over across time, and it's not new. This is something that's been a continual experience with our population within this country for some time, but addressing it, bringing it up, brings some solutions. You want to start chiming in, brother? What's your thoughts on it so far?
Yeah, so first of all, thank you for having us on the show to deal with these subjects, dear brother. Malcolm X once made the comment that the police force is an occupying force in our community. When you consider how the police force even started, these were men who were commissioned in their community to hunt down slaves. In the history of law enforcement, they generally would hire Irishmen because they were good hunters or good at tracking slaves down. So that's where the whole term paddy wagon comes from, because it was the Irish that was going around rounding up the runaway slaves. In the 1950s, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was having a debate with J.B. Stoner, who was the Grand Imperial Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan at the time. And during that debate, towards the end of the debate, after Honorable Elijah Muhammad smacked him up quite a bit, he made the comment that we're wearing white robes today, but tomorrow we'll be wearing black robes. Tomorrow we'll be wearing business suits. So he also said tomorrow we'll be wearing police uniforms. So he was giving us a clear indication back in the 1950s that where there wasn't any racism amongst law enforcement, it's coming. So you've had areas or segments in the community throughout America whereas racism was prevalent in law enforcement. In some communities it weren't as bad, but they infiltrated and flooded law enforcement. They infiltrated the court system with racist white supremacy mindsets. So you have judges who are behind the scenes Ku Klux Klansmen or neo-Nazis. You have lawyers or prosecutors who are neo-Nazis. You have those who are in law enforcement, police chiefs, inspectors, officers, sergeants, who have that mindset. Now, with respect to Sandra Bland, as we have all agreed, this is nothing new, but why now is it happening so out in the open? And not just Sandra Bland, but right after her, there were other reports that kind of got snuffed out in the media of five other sisters under police custody having similar situations as Sandra Bland.
That's right.
So they're not even talking about that.
They're not even talking about that. So, and you're highlighting that there is was a deliberate deploy of white supremacy and racism not only being embedded, but being the foundation of law enforcement and the development of law enforcement in this country, especially as it relates to its policing and relationship to black folks.
Absolutely.
Coming from slavery to sharecropping and Jim Crow well into the 21st century.
Absolutely.
And how it relates also to, you know, other cases being not really created a large notoriety to it, a public outcry for it, but there were other cases that happened around the same time that Sandra Bland lost her life in incarceration. So the first question that we want to get into then is, what implication does this have on us as a people? We're seeing our sister, who was about to start a new job down in Texas at her alma mater. She was excited to go into this new direction with her career, has a history of being successful academically, and just coming from a family background, a family knit background of women who were close, had a good solid relationship, and had a foundation to setting her up for success. But she loses her life inside of a jail cell that was, in a sense, supposed to be video, you know, on the video surveillance and guarded, but yet she, you know, she died from asphyxiation. You know, she hung herself. We don't believe that. So what type of impact does this have on our community? Let's talk about it.
I'm going to be honest. I'm gonna start it off. I've been saying the same thing for years, and I've actually taken steps in my own life. It has been open season on us for a minute. I don't know why we're so slow to react. I don't think there should be widespread panic in our communities, but I think we should embrace each other's brothers and sisters. I think that our brothers should offer out that protection to sisters as well. If anything, to me, it's a call, not only a call to arms, because it is, but to be more socially responsible, to be more aware of what we say, more aware of what we do. I'm a grown man. When I travel cross country in my car, I was constantly getting a barrage of phone calls from my mom, my cousin, my brother. Where you at? What state are you in? What city are you crossing by? Are you awake? Do you feel fine? I don't know whether Sandra Bland had this or not in her corner. But once she got stopped, that ability to make that phone call, the fact that she reached out and nobody was aware, it's sad, it's tragic. Now, I'm not saying that it's the family's fault. I'm not placing blame on the family. But you got, you know, your daughter, you know what I'm saying? Somebody's daughter traveling across country. Somebody should have been checking on her just to see.
Right.
I think that it's definitely a call to arms to be more aware. We can't continue to leave things out in the open thinking that it won't be taken advantage of. We got to close that rank, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's definitely a call to arms, and it brings into the conversation of how we have defense you know, conversations and discussions amongst our people. How do we talk about not only our self-well-being, but our self-defense, but how do we set up a network where we, like you're describing, folks are just aware and accountable to where we have family members or community members going. You know, if my brother is leaving out of town for an event, it's good that he connects with his other brothers. Hey, I'm leaving to this state and city. I just want to make sure that y'all know. And those brothers are following up with him on phone calls, text messages, making sure they know his whereabouts. So that way we have that network of defense. So if he was to get arrested or come up missing, there's someone always on standby who's ready to alert the community and respond accordingly. And so it does bring that conversation up as well. It also brings up that conversation of, you know, men. And this is just my perspective, and I'm going to pass it on. What is our obligations to protecting our community? You know, what is our obligation of protecting Black women? What is our obligation of protecting our children? You know, and where does that go into institutionally, network-wise, family-wise, and even to the surveillance and just understanding of what is our position in the community as a whole, you know? So it brings in some of those questions, like what is our role, and do we have to redefine that in the 21st century, you know, in light of we know that there's a specific target by law enforcement?
Well, if you just look at our experience here in America, in slavery, they castrated the man in front of his family. They degraded and devalued the man in front of his family. They beat and maimed the man and took off body parts and used them as trophies in front of the family so that through time, through generations, where the man was on a pedestal as being a provider, the maintainer, the protector, the guardian, the leader of their household, you set up a circumstance where through generational, embedded through our minds, our DNA, and our consciousness, there be a predisposition, whereas that respect level is gradually moved away to almost where it's just gone and diminished. Once you remove that, once the protector, the provider, and the maintainer of the family is taken out of the equation, you know, in warfare, in military terms, anytime you conquer an area or conquer a country, the spoils of war is called the booty. So after you've conquered a situation, you go after the spoils of war. Well, our most valuable asset is our woman. She's our most valuable asset. So once you've gotten a man out of the picture, then they go after the woman. So you see it in the media, whereas we've had our men just slammed all over the media, social media, public media, whatever. Now, we've been desensitized. So there's no rallying cry to the level where it's supposed to be when it comes to protecting our women and our children. Because one thing for certain, as men, we're obligated to provide and maintain and protect our families. And before we let anything happen to our women, we go down first. But we're not going down without a fight. You know, so we have to change that dynamic. You know, this has been going on generationally, and what we have to do now is police ourselves. When you have an occupying force, that's law enforcement, in a community that they have no invested interest in, they wasn't born and raised in that community, they don't know the neighbors, you know, their grandmother isn't neighbors with the person across the street, you know, just that camaraderie that you have growing up in a neighborhood. Anytime something happens that's of negative impact, you're desensitized to it because you don't have any invested interest in that community. So what has to happen is that wherever law enforcement is going to be, we must police ourselves.
Nice. So finding ways to create law enforcement systems within our
community. Absolutely.
Jim, you want to close this segment out?
I think that kind of going off of what each individual up here has said, I think that one of the things that we need to take a look at is, you know, in order to move to policing ourselves, I think with this breakdown of the family in the African-American community, I think we have to start there, because I know as a man myself, I have a vested interest in protecting my family and providing for my family. And I was talking to a young man the other day, and I was trying to explain to him and asking him what is manhood. And I said there's different levels to it, and certain levels to it is protecting your family and all those things. And he named those things, he was able to name those things, but I said, well, there's another level to it, and that's protecting your community. It's having a vested interest in your community. And so many of our young men, I think, are because of the family breakdown and the family structure and things that plague our community in that particular area, we haven't been able to, it's harder to pull together nowadays. So I think that's where we need to start. It start with particularly individuals who have families who have a vested interest in their children growing up in 10 or 15 or 20 years. And we need to start there and build out from there.
So building that family structure, the black family structure, is like one of the key defenses with being able to police ourselves and move into a more of a self-defense network in order to protect ourselves with that. On the next segment, we want to start exploring. We want to ask the question, how do we hold the system accountable for creating these type of atrocities against our people?
I'm Thomas Berry, and I'll be moderating this segment, and we're going to talk about solutions. How can we hold the government as citizens accountable to make sure that we don't have more situations like the Sandra Bland case? With me, I got Brother Javon, as well as Brother Antonio and Brother Andrew. I'll turn to you, Brother Andrew, first. What are some of the things that you think that we can do as a people to hold the government accountable for situations like these?
I think, again, everything that I starting off, I think everything that I my opinion will come out of the family and structure, and bringing our families together and figuring out what do we want our families to look like in the next 10 years, in the next 20 years. What are some of the solutions and things that we want to target and bring about those changes? And so we have to start there. And so once we compile those things and what we want that to look like, then we just get to work, you know, and figuring out solutions in different ways to make that happen and bring about that change. And so that starts, I think, with the family.
Brother Javon, what do you say?
You know, to follow up with Brother Andrew said, I would definitely agree it starts with the family and creating a collective of families, you know, to become tribal again, to become more of a community again, and to be on one accord, and understand that we're not always going to agree on that solution, but to understand the greater goal of getting what we all want as a people, you know, and ultimately we want to be respected, right? And come back to me.
All right, I'll come back to you. Brother Antonio?
I agree with both brothers. Everything, when you're dealing with a nation, it starts with family. Family's the bedrock of community. Community's the bedrock of nation. So in order to have strong communities, we've got to have strong families. And they're not going to respect us until we, first of all, respect ourselves. Our unity will solve 95% of our problems.
Right.
When you're dealing with a child, let's just say your wife backed a fresh batch of cookies, and she take the cookies out the oven, set them on the countertop, set them in a cookie jar. She goes away, goes to the store. When a child thinks it can get away with something that it wants, that it has as an inner desire, when nobody's looking, they're gonna go get the cookie because nobody's present. They don't think there's any gonna be any consequences. They're not taking into consideration mom may have counted the cookies before she put them in the cookie jar. So without no system of accountability, without no system of executing consequences for actions, people are gonna continue to get away with what they think they can get away with. But if we have enough self-respect in our community, where some of the differences that we have amongst ourselves, instead of putting a public display on World Star Hip Hop or allowing news cameras to watch our foolishness, You know, any differences that we have, it should be settled behind closed doors. And there's no problem that can't be solved. We just all have to have a willingness to solve them. So in a sense, I hate to say it, but as of right now, a lot of us have been pacified. And the circumstances in the world that are dictating the affairs of these that continue to aggress in our community the way they are, it's going to force our hand to unite.
Right.
So this is definitely something that a negative situation that can turn out to be something positive, because a lot of the talking, the conferencing, the meetings, you know, sessions like this, it helps.
Right.
But it hasn't really given us what we need to really have that force to unite. Because they're going to continue to do as long as they feel like there's no consequences for their actions. And there's a consequence coming, but we'll talk about that later.
You want to add on to what you were saying earlier?
I think that it's important to understand, like, in the beginning, right? Because we got to strategically get there, right? So it's important to understand that we don't need everyone, that we can start with just my family, your family, and so forth, and try to make a wave for other people to follow. Because ultimately, everybody's not leaders, and everybody's not fit to take on the role of leadership or have that huge amount of responsibility.
Right.
But we as men, as fathers,
as
protectors and providers of our family, we can definitely come on one accord.
Right.
And make that decision for our families.
Right.
And then hopefully, you know, we create an attraction, a wave or a connection for other people to say, hey, you know, I like what they're doing.
Right.
I want to move how they're moving.
Right.
You know, and so that's just the one piece that I would add to that.
And I just want to add, I recently went to Texas and I went to this community. And when I went to the community, I saw that it was, you know, black elected officials, black police officers, black businesses, black homeowners. And they had very little to low crime at all. Poverty levels were low, family rates were high. So the family aspect is very important. Another thing that I think is important is strength in numbers. I think that in the Twin Cities, if you look at the Northwest suburbs, Brooklyn Park, Brooklyn Center, you have an excellent opportunity to move out there, and we're already 51% of the population. Why do we move other places? Why do we look at other things? We like to be different, and I think that's our weakness. I think if you look at the Sandra Bland shooting, her murder, you look at some of the shootings around the country, we're always in spots where there's little of us in populations or in pockets. There's not enough of us there. So you can shoot a brother in the back, you know, in South Carolina, if that's the only brother around. You can't shoot that brother in the back if there's 10 brothers that's around, or 10 families that are around that got each other's back. Or if you say a whole community of brothers that have each other back. And I see what I think was different from us, African Americans, compared to other ethnic groups, is other ethnic groups, they move around each other. Jewish people live in Jewish communities. Asian, whether it's Hmong, whether it's Chinese, whether it's Japanese, they live in the same communities. Somalians, they live in the same communities. So you see people living amongst each other, and then you see African Americans who are spread out. And we have a plethora of excuses on why we're spread out, right? Mm-hmm. But the fact is, it's easier to knock you off, kill you, whether it's the men, whether it's the women, or the children, if you're not in the community that you have as yours, if you don't have businesses that are set up, if you don't have elected officials. So what I would like, what I think a great solution is that you can hold the government accountable if you have municipalities in place, which we have none of. And that's part of the reason why you pay taxes. You pay taxes to make sure you get fair policing. You pay taxes to make sure that the legislation that's getting passed in the state or in the city is going your way. So I think part of the accountability piece, or holding them accountable, is us putting those numbers together. I know we love the North Side. I love the North Side. I work over North. You know, we have some ties to North Minneapolis. But at the same time, are we putting those numbers that we have there, are we putting that to use? You know, why do we have so many different ethnic groups representing Northside? Why is it Blongay? Why is it a Raymond Dean? Why isn't it the brothers and sisters who are running for those seats? So when you ask for why do these things keep happening, why do we have Terrence Franklin's, why is that constantly happening, in my opinion, it's because we're not using those numbers. We're constantly trying to figure out ways to spread ourselves apart. Brother Andrew, you want to add on to that?
I think you guys brought up a good point. The family structure, as I mentioned before, is the foundation of everything. But the piece that you just touched on is talking about businesses and institutions. I think Malcolm X said the purpose of an institution is the purpose of a school is to bring about the ideas of the people who gave rise to that institution. And so I think that we need to start again pulling our resources together. Let's just say it's a place to change our oil in our cars, and Brother Antonio wanted to do that, then we need to start going to Brother Antonio so that we can start circulating our dollars and pooling our resources together and supporting our institutions and our community, so that when there's opportunities, we can take advantage of them a lot better.
Right.
As you talked about, when you're talking about pulling our resources together, but we can't do that if we're all spread apart, you know, geographically and, you know, economically.
Right. That's right.
And Brother Antonio, you want to add on to that?
Yes, sir. That's a very valid point there, brother. You know, the night that Martin Luther King gave his last speech down in Memphis, he was there dealing with the pain of the garbage men who were suffering injustices from the city.
Right.
And he spoke about how the pain must be redistributed. And he talked about our black dollars, our collective dollars. How at that time, collectively in America, amongst 22 million black people, we were bringing in $30 billion
right.
a year. Right now, as 45 million black people, some would say 50 million, depending on who you're asking. But right now we bring in $1.3 trillion.
Right.
But our money doesn't even circulate in our community once, whereas in other communities it circulates 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 times.
Right.
So when you have really nothing to fight for, like, you know, we say we have on, you know, have some invested interest in North Minneapolis per se because it's a predominantly black community, but what is it in North Minneapolis that we actually own?
Right.
The idea that you had about Brooklyn Center and Brooklyn Park, I really like that, because the more of us that are there, when you have a conglomerate of us in one city like that, we can take total control of the city council. Whereas right now, if we put all of our attention in North Minneapolis per se, that's one seat on the city council. So even if we have a strong united collective effort on one side of town with respect to changing policy, changing laws, that's one vote against another 6, 7, or 8 votes.
Right.
You know, so we gotta have total control over governing our affairs where we can really hold our elected officials accountable.
Right.
And if you notice, anytime something goes wrong, you know, as we were talking about the dollars, anytime something goes wrong and there's rioting that's about to take place, that slogan, protect and serve, from law enforcement, they protect the interests of businesses, of buildings. Property is more important, inanimate objects is more important than the lives of human beings. Because it's not our businesses.
Right.
It's theirs and their cousins and their uncles and their aunts. But when we have our own community and our own businesses, our own schools, our own gas stations, grocery stores, when we have total control over our community, we're invested to protect that which was ours. Now, unfortunately, we don't have that, but that's what it's gonna take. So when we talk about unity, we're not just saying, oh, we're all in agreement, because none of us will ever see everything eye to eye. That's impossible.
Right.
But having a collective effort of self-interest, whereas we're gonna have our own schools, have our own clinics, hospitals, our own businesses, when we have our own community, we can do that. And we've had that in the past, but we didn't protect it.
Right.
We had Tulsa, Oklahoma, but in addition to Tulsa, Oklahoma, we had 60 other black towns throughout the South coming up out of the Reconstruction era during slavery.
Right.
But we did not protect them. We were afraid of those who came in our communities to destroy our communities, but this is a different generation now. Once we have something now, I believe we have the wherewithal amongst our peers that anything that we have, it'll definitely be protected. We just got to make it happen and go get it.
And I just want to correct, we do have it. That's what I was talking about, DeSoto, Texas.
Yes.
We do have it. Yes. And DeSoto's not the only town. I'm pretty sure there's more towns across the U.S. that have those things. And when you have elected officials, then those elected officials can hold other elected officials responsible mm-hmm. for the Sandra Blands. So that police chief can go on and say, hey, you know what, by the way, that's one of my citizens inside of my parish, whether inside of my town, inside of my city. And we don't like what we're doing. We want to investigate exactly what happened so we can make sure that this sister and her family gets justice.
Right.
That's why it's important for the institution builder. Families are the first institution. And that's the important institution because it helps all the other institutions grow. But when we are looking at what we have today, we have sisters like Sandra Bland who locked up just for not refusing to put out her cigarette, which she didn't have to. The tape clearly shows that she was cooperating, but the cop didn't feel like he was going to be held responsible for his actions. He wasn't hiding what he was doing. His dash cam camera caught all of this. So he didn't feel like he was going to be held accountable. So that's what we have to do. We have to figure out more ways. We have to invade or take over cities, if you will, like they white flight, right? We move in, they move out. So we know if we move into Brooklyn Park, Brooklyn Center, they're going to move out. They have over $1.3 billion coming into that area based off of the transit rail. Black people need to get on board. I know we're prideful about North Minneapolis, South Minneapolis, St. Paul, or what have you, but strength is in numbers. You want your children to be in healthy environments and healthy schools, not worrying about it? Go visit DeSoto like I did. You start seeing black women able to walk and run, and they're not looking over their backs. They're not worried about it. Brothers are able to drive their cars. They're not worried about being pulled over by a cop who got his hand on his gun, ready to shoot them dead. So you can't do that when you're in charge. You can't be treated that way. So as far as solutions, would you all agree that unity is one of the main cores of that?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
All right.
Absolutely.
All right, so welcome back. And in this segment, we are going to talk about the critically acclaimed movie, Straight Outta Compton. So in this, we're gonna just really be bouncing back and forth, throwing some ideas out, different opinions, and hopefully offer something to the community that help build more discussion around movies and movies that are depicted as biopic form that talks about issues in our community. So I'm gonna dive in and say for myself, starting off, I wasn't really too impressed with the movie. I think the movie was a good piece of entertainment. I loved the actors that was depicted with different folks, different characters who was in there. I think they did a phenomenal job with that. But my opinion as far as the entertainment value does not connect to it being a biopic. I think it was weak as far as being able to tell a story. An actual story, a biographical form of what happened with the different people in NWA, and I think it watered down and reframed the group into a different context that wasn't actually accurate in the events of history. So I'm gonna start off with that. I'm not a fan of it. I didn't think the movie placed any deeper meaning or biopic value that we have to glean from our community and make this extreme connection to how things were back then. I'm pretty sure our generation appreciated it. However, I would never use that movie in anything beyond just entertainment value.
What you know? I'm gonna go last.
I'm gonna have to go the other way on that one. I really enjoyed the film. Like you said, the entertainment value was strong, but for me, I thought for a generation of kids who didn't grow up with NWA, who didn't understand what they stood for, that the movie did a pretty good job in making a direct correlation between what was going on at the time with violence with police officers, with the beating of Rodney King. I find that one of the big ironies that we as a people didn't learn from that movie or didn't learn from that situation was you got Rodney King getting beat for the first time in American history was caught on tape. even with overwhelming, obvious, Ray Charles and Stevie Wonder can see it, evidence, those cops still got off. 30 years later, we still videotaping cops instead of jumping on them. I think we missed the boat on that one. As far as the movie's concerned, you got 3 hours. How much of an individual's life, and we're talking about a group, can you truly condense a man's life to fit in 3 hours? That's one person. With 4 or 5 different personalities, things are gonna get missed, things are gonna get left out. But that I lived in a generation where a group of young brothers could come together, have that kind of impact in an album and a half or 2 albums, and for most of that group to be alive to even talk about it later is impressive within itself on its own merit. Usually we appreciate our black musicians and our black authors and everybody that gives to the black from ourselves. We usually die in the process, broke and penniless. So for them to be successful still and to have lived through that, I think the movie is amazing. I'm pretty sure I'll be using it as a teaching tool at some point.
You know, it's funny. I think the movie, you're gonna take from it what you wanna take from it. You know, your perception of it is gonna be based on your own personal experiences. Me being a young man, you know, I was, 7, 8 when NWA hit the scene. And so I might not have had the full grasp of what I was witnessing when they actually came on the scene. But one thing I can say from watching the movie, I took away from it some powerful things. I thought it was powerful that that Cube, you know, can create and mold his own story how he sees fit, and accepted the responsibility in that, and by putting up his own money, right? And then for it to become successful, right? So what it does is it creates a blueprint for other people to follow. And now you'll have the conversation of No Limit movie coming out or a Cash Money movie coming out, which, you know, creates economics for them as black men and their families. I think that when you're young and you're rebellious, you know, if you're in a rebellious state or what have you, you have the ability to look at this movie and say, these were some young men who didn't take no shit, excuse my language, who just simply was like against all odds or against the threat of even the government imposing their will on them, or against, you know, the police who threatened them with jail or what have you. They took a stance for their creative art to do it, and I can admire that. You know, I can take a lot of traits from the movie and say, you know, this is positive, or this is how I can put this into my own life. I'm gonna speak my mind regardless of the danger. I'm going to stand on my own too, and I'm gonna utilize my free speech. And if you, regardless of your perception of who I am, you know, I'm gonna present myself how I see fit, and I'm not going to mold myself to fit into your world. For instance, like when the reporter came to visit Cube at his home and Cube checked him, I thought that was brilliant. I thought that was beautiful, and I thought that was an important piece. Or when Cube was on stage, he said, I didn't care about what the police had to say. You know, I'm gonna perform my song. You know, and I think that those are some important aspects of manhood, to be able to just stand on your own two and to have a value for yourself and bring that to the table, you know.
And for me, I just wanna shout out my homeboy Boo Jones, Ronnie Jones. I remember him coming to my house in 1989. Came to my house, he had a tape that he got from his auntie, and it was the NWA tape. And he told me I had to listen to this tape, and it stuck with me ever since. And what the movie did for me, it reminded me of how we used to be. Before brothers allowed themselves to be what the old folks call hen-checked, you know, where the wives are talking more than the men are talking. We see Black Lives Matter movements, and we see women doing it. We don't see men doing anything in this country. Part of it is because there's a fear that's been laced over us if we talk. So we're scared to say, as a collective, F the police. We have maybe one brother saying it, maybe 10 brothers saying it, but we didn't have millions of people saying it at one time. We don't have that at one time now. when someone gets shot by the police, we have black people who are coming up with the excuses on why their brother got shot. NWA, the movie, to me, just it put me back into the mind of how we used to be, how our generation, Generation X, was looked upon that we were gonna change the world because we were gonna be unapologetic. I know there's a lot of negative things that you can say about those brothers, but every biopic story, every person in history has something negative that you can say about them. Whether it's the Malcolm X story, whether it's the Black Panther story, what have you, it's always something. It's always a major piece that's left out. It's always a major piece that's changed in the movie. That's because of the entertainment part. And we can't forget that it is entertainment. People have to be entertained to buy the ticket. And I think that we hold each other to a standard that we don't hold our white counterparts to. We're not combing over every Mel Gibson story and saying, but wait a minute, remember those racial epithets that he was saying on the voicemail? We're not saying about Schwarzenegger when he does the thing. Hey, do you remember how he cheated on his wife with the maid? That's not a part of the conversation. We're not asking him to apologize for those things. We're not asking nobody white to apologize for anything that they've done. But soon as we put brothers on the screen, now all of a sudden things that happened 30 years ago, now that's a part of a conversation. Now we have to be reminded that, yes, sisters do get beat up. Well, was Dr. Dre the original wife beater? The original domestic violence person? Why don't we talk about the other people that are beating on their wives? How come now all of a sudden because they put out a movie and then sisters want to write about it? I'm sorry, D. Barnes got paid. Did we forget that D. Barnes got paid? I think that kind of escapes our mind. Do we forget that Michelle A., yeah, Dre might have been beating on her, but she also got with Suge, and Suge also made life threats against Dre. So we can't say that she's totally innocent in that situation because she put that man's life in danger as well with her relationship. So to me, when I look at it, it's everybody has a story to tell. How they tell their story is not always 100% true, but we should accept it for what it is. Our generation, we have some valuable things that we need to pass on. The biggest thing from the movie was their group. We have young men walking around now trying to be individuals. We're not even talking about the group aspect. See, that's totally over our head because we think that automatically we're all together. We use words that don't mean nothing. Community. We don't even have communities no more. We have communities, we don't have groups. So to me, when I saw Straight Outta Compton, it brought me back to, okay, this is how we used to think. Remember how we used to think in we instead of me, right? And it also let me see that Jerry Heller, he couldn't deal with the real NWA as a group. That's why he pulled Eazy-E aside. That's why he had to do Eazy like that, talk to Eazy by himself. That shows you the weakness in the individualism that we show. Because people can break us down into one, then they can manipulate that one. You can't manipulate five cats in a room. Because then you might have an Ice Cube that's gonna ask the question, like he kept asking, what about our contracts? What about our money? So I think that the story is important. Now, do I think that there's some negative things the NWA brought to the table? Of course, but when you're young, that's the side effects of being young and misguided. Do we blame them for being misguided? Or do we blame the people, their elders that were not depicted in the movies, the people that could have gave them more education? My last thing was, the most important segment to me was the opening with the Crenshaw blood when he got on the bus. And that's something that we always hear about older guys back in our generation, the old hustlers, the old gangbangers who come to you and tell you, you don't want to be a part of this life. This ain't what you want. You need to think about that. That was a very important moment in the movie to me because like he said, hey, you throwing up these gang signs and you might end up running into me. Now, remind you, those kids started off in a school that was in the suburbs. So they didn't know anything about gangbanging. And what we have now today in this society, we have kids who come from suburban lifestyles who want to be in the streets, that want to be in the gang. They're not ready for it. And that's why we have so many young black men and black girls who are being gunned down. They're not prepared for that life, but there's nobody older than them telling them, no, this is not what you want, because this is the reality of what's going to happen. Back to you.
This is where I'm going to push back on. I'm not sure if I would want to promote this movie beyond its entertainment value to try to pull some of those symbolisms and those imageries that y'all presenting as if it's a good marker or a good tool to use to have those type of conversations and discussions. So two, to go to one point that was made, because I really like what Javon said about pulling those aspects of manhood. It's good. I think we have a lot of other mediums and tools as far as movies that we can use for that. But if we want to try to say Cube Vision and F. Gary Gray and Dr. Dre and what they produce, we should try to pull some value in it. I will go that to that extent and pull that piece out. But I'm not going to criticize Mel Gibson with Braveheart. You know, the whole conflict between the Irish and Scottish and the English, that's not my experience. My experience is with the Black experience here. So I'm obligated to sit up here and love Ice Cube, Dr. Dre, and F. Gary Gray enough to say, hey, this medium that y'all put forth, can we qualify that as a biopic? Or is this a creative narrative that is talking about something that happened in actual, that have some actual elements and historical elements in it, but is it really a biopic? Because then we do have to ask another question. Are we willing to alter events in the past for monetary entertainment value? And do we have, if we have that much control over the institutions and the mediums that we put forth about our own narrative and experience and put it into a film and try to make money off of it, do we have to be obligated to the images and the symbolic imageries that we put into the movies, especially when it comes to the depiction of women in the film, let alone how we commit 34 minutes to juxtapose NWA into this political background, like they was this voice against law enforcement and police brutality. See, that's the piece I didn't buy. And let alone how they reframed and made it seem like that the record labels didn't have an influence on the creative narrative of what the images they put out as NWA gangsters on these albums. Because these brothers was not that experience. I think they did do a good job with that beginning intro piece where the brothers got on the school bus and checked them, because it juxtaposed them and their life to what was really happening. So Ice Cube was right. He was just a journalist talking about what was going on. But these brothers tried to live it and tried to say that this is what they was about. So if we're gonna have that much creative control on how we tell our narrative and try to get folks to buy that ticket, shouldn't we be honest to our community? So those questions is what rises to me, because 34 minutes was committed to make it seem like NWA was this voice against this type of social and political climate. But then we're like, wait a minute, what was Public Enemy doing at this time? So anyway, I'm sorry, I gotta pass it. Go ahead.
We got no more time, man. I have to answer. I'm as succinctly and as quickly as I can.
Uh-huh.
I feel like if you follow the careers of Dre and Cube, once they were no longer under the influence of NWA, the career decisions and choices that they made show you that they understood that they were selling the image and selling the brand. I agree with you that the gangster are harder than life stories, the narratives. What might have been a machinations of the machine behind them.
Mm-hmm.
But like Thomas said, and this is the biggest part I want to take away from this, I can't speak for everybody else, but I had a parent, I had older cousins in my ear going, bro, there's no way in the world with one 9mm gun do you shoot 25 people. Understand that's not going to happen, cuz.
That's right.
Understand that you can't confess for murder on tape and not get got. Mm. We had older people in our ears tell us, and the kids now don't have that. Mm. Let us know. Hey, you don't confess for.
But there's quite a few who didn't have it then, though.
That was true, but I kid you not, for those people in my circle who took everything NWA and any other rap group said for face value, if they didn't get checked by somebody, then when I got checked by my family, I checked them.
Mm.
Because I feel like in our era, we were a little more responsible. We all clown that dude that took NWA a little bit too hard, the kid that wore the hammer pants. But a person that took the belief system and went a little bit too far to the left. If the family didn't do it, if the friends didn't do it, then one of us was like, hey, for real, dude. No, he didn't do that.
Or it was a part of the dozens, right? Mm-hmm. So you were uncomfortable if you took it too far. And so I think when you look at this movie, right, and I'm a father, so I can have no problem with my child as a teenager allowing them to watch the movie, because I can break certain things down. You have to understand that children are attracted to certain things for certain reasons. And when you're a child, your mind isn't as developed as an adult, so you have a rebellious nature. There are things that you want to get into because of your curiosity, right? So the children of this generation will be more interested in a Straight Outta Compton as opposed to a movie about Public Enemy. And that's just being honest. And so whatever they have presented in front of them, if you as an elder or a father or uncle are around these children, you have the responsibility and the ability to point them in the right direction, to guide them, and to make an example out of what's wrong with this movie, and then feed them also certain things that may be right with the movie, or certain things that you can take from it, or certain examples. So I think it's important to not just make it seem like life is this sugar-coated great thing where nothing bad happens. You use the bad examples in life to teach your children the right way to go.
Close it out, TV.
Close it out. I'll be there in the next segment.
All right.
So continuing with the segment, I just want to say this about the movie. I feel like it's important to realize that we're the only ethnic group that does this publicly, where we challenge each other anytime we see one another successful. Whether it's Michael Jordan selling shoes, and we bring up the fact of what he's not doing for our community, whether it's NWA in a movie, and all of a sudden we got to bring up everything that they've done wrong, like we've never supported other people who've done criminal acts or what have you. So I just find it strange that all of a sudden at a time where the culture wars is about to start around the election. We talked about this the last show, where now you're about to have black men versus black women. And we don't see how we're getting used as a pawn. While Dee Barnes and all the sisters are talking about what Dr. Dre is and the misogyny of the movie, I'm sorry, are we the original misogynists? And what other shows are you supporting that are full of misogyny? Are you supporting Scandal? Are you supporting Death by Numbers, where black women are pretty much the side pieces on these shows? See, nobody wants to talk about those things. So I can't criticize Dr. Dre in one post and then the next post be talking about Olivia Pope. It just doesn't make sense to me. So I just think that we have to figure it out, and we have to be responsible with the images that are portrayed on camera, right? But we have to also look at the importance. And last but not least, you said Public Enemy. Are we forgetting that Flavor Flav, Flavor of Love, that's not misogynistic? He's not a member of Public Enemy? He's still in the group? So they get a pass for that. But we have to, and that's real recent. But then we have to knock Dr. Dre them for something that happened 30 years ago. So we have to really choose our battles and how we're publicly displaying things. And then another thing is, we're not going after VH1 for those shows like Flavor of Love. We're not saying that those things need to be shut down. We're not trying to take money out their pockets. We're trying to take the money out of the pockets of the Ice Cubes, the F. Gary Grays, and the others. And I'm saying as a people, we do have issues, but those are in-house issues. Those are not Facebook issues. That's not on your blog issues. We need to have more summits. We need to have more things where we're talking behind doors. We can change our culture that way. We're not going to be changing our culture by pointing the fingers. And while Public Enemy was around, and I love P.E., I'm telling you, there was never in my life a stronger lesson than F the police. Trust me. That sticks in your mind.
Fight the power.
But Fight the Power came out after.
And still.
But listen to what I'm saying.
That's my piece.
But Fight the Power. Fight the Power was your piece, but Fight the Power also was the piece of the Isley Brothers. Yeah. Let's remember where they got it from. Mm-hmm. Let's remember where they got it from. So that wasn't Public Enemy's thing. That was the Isley Brothers thing. And we're not even talking about how Public
Enemy...
But could
Isley get it to the people the way the Public Enemy did?
I don't know. Could Public Enemy keep Professor Griffin in the group
the same? We still hear Public Enemy fight the power to this day.
That's true.
But we don't hear the Isley Brothers.
That's true. But could Public Enemy keep Professor Griffin in the group for saying about them selling dope to the brother man instead of the other man? Mm. See, they keep the brother out of the group, so we're not even talking about that because that was the fact of the message. Mm-hmm. So we got one group that was unapologetic on one hand, and then we got another group who gave an apology, but then we're talking about this group who gave an apology is the one that should be standing up for us. I'm sorry, they gave an apology. Not only did they give an apology, but then they also had one of their front runners in the group showing out as a pimp on VH1.
Right.
So how are they the group that we're supposed to be saying, oh, well, we need to be like Public Enemy?
So here's the asterisk to this. If Brothers Bill video shoot was on 5-6 years ago, we'll be talking about Flavor Flav right now, and it's a misogynistic perspective on VH1. So we know where we're at with that, brothers. But two, also with that is that we do, I agree with you on that. There's certain private conversations that we have to have. And I think we talked about that in one of our kind of local think tank discussions, that there's certain things that we need to do in-house. There's certain conversations that we should not air out and let it be a proxy war for the larger institutions to make us divisive against one another. Using issues like that around domestic issues to divide us when it comes to social and political situations. However, in this situation, we cannot allow ourselves to be dumb or alienated to those issues in our community. Black domestic violence is a real issue,
yes.
Okay? And it can't be muzzled just because the sister could not get a platform to be to have this conversation talked about in a larger piece, and she had to ride the incline of the publication and marketing of this movie. I mean, I'm not saying that I excuse Dee Barnes and how she went about doing this. This is how she had to go about doing it, and all of a sudden now her message is being echoed to a larger public. However, my piece is that it's not so much comparing Public Enemy to NWA from the movie's perspective. I'm saying that I cannot buy in to NWA being that political voice juxtaposed to what Public Enemy was doing at that time. Because I feel like they committed 34 minutes to creating that frame and putting NWA in this position of being this voice against state authority and law enforcement when they wasn't. We all know, we're from that generation. We know that wasn't their platform. That's not what they started off with, okay? Now, do I put NWA and Public Enemy in the same category? As far as the cultural expression that come out of black folks, yes. But as far as their political tone and how they address the social climate of us in the 1989, 80, 90, 91, no, they don't belong in the same category. That movie is trying to frame them like they was, and I just can't accept that.
So let me interject, Paul.
I
want to say they do, and I'm going to tell you why, because we always talk about these groups and we talk about the group trees. Mm-hmm. The reason why you can't say that with NWA after Ice Cube left, because Ice Cube was the political writer. So if you go into the America's Most Wanted, you go into the death certificates, remember those things were produced by Public Enemy's producing squad. So that is still on the same tree. And they saw each other as peers. And I remember when people used to buy tapes. Remember that? People used to buy tapes.
Yeah.
When you look at the inserts, NWA gave shout outs to groups like Boogie Down Productions, Public Enemy, X-Clan.
Mm-hmm.
Those same groups gave shout outs to those brothers as well, because they understood they were all in it together. They went on tour together. What we have going on now, we have the fans who are separating and dividing these brothers. These brothers are not separated and divided. They understand the importance of one another. And I will go on to say that even those groups gave props to groups like Salt and Pepper, Kid and Play. They understood the aspect that all of them were needed to make this thing go. The problem that we have as the people now is we put people in these compartmental boxes. And we do this because white folks have taught us to do this, to start saying, you know what, Malcolm and Martin, those are two different things. No, they're not. Those are two brothers that's fighting against the same oppression. They just have two different ways of going about doing it. They're both needed. So we need Public Enemy, and we need NWA. We need that brother who said, you know what, I ain't read a book, but I will mess you up about my people. Then we need a brother to say, you know what, I read a book and I'm going to talk to you, educated about it, but if you don't give me my way, you remember my other brother, the one that don't read? Well, he ain't got no time for this. He's going to be the one that's going to show up if you don't give me my way. So we need to have the NWAs and the Public Enemies, but we can't have that as long as we're constantly separating these brothers up. That's my, and I will tell you, 5-6 years ago, I still wouldn't have brought up Flavor Flav and his misogyny, because that's a part of entertainment. So I understand.
You wouldn't have talked about it?
I wouldn't have talked about it, because I feel like that. Because to me personally, I feel like it's entertainment. Either you're buying it or you're not buying it. It's not something that I'm buying. I never watched the show. So if I never watched the show, I can care less for it. Would I want my children to watch the show? No, but I'm not going to hop on no publication.
But wouldn't that be reason to talk about it? It's because a lot of our children was
in-house.
Yeah, of course.
In-house.
Yeah, of course.
I'm not going to go like Dee Barnes. I'm not going to get on public to bash this brother, and then I'm not talking about the other things that's going on in society, because now we're focusing on NWA, but the previous two segments back, we were just talking about Sister Sandra
Bland.
So now we're not talking about Sandra Bland and the white man that possibly killed her. Now we're talking about this brother who whooped on his sister 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. See how that's different? Now we don't want to talk about the sister who got killed by the white guy. We got to go back to the black man being the bad guy because he beat up on his sister. She's still breathing. She still got a lawsuit. What's Sandra Bland family got? See, we don't understand how they use us to manipulate the conversations. Mm-hmm. because the conversation out of Straight Outta Compton, it should have been focused on the police and police brutality. We could have looped all of that together and say, hey, they're still doing the exact same thing. Brother said last segment, Rodney King was the first time. I'm sorry, you go back to the 50s and 60s, it was plenty instances on television. 20s and 30s with them beating us illegally. Mm-hmm. And nobody was getting charged.
Nobody got indicted. Right. Yeah.
So Brother Andrew, I'm gonna let you hop on in there.
Well, I would like to start off by saying, I'd give him a disclaimer. I have not seen the NWA movie.
Oh, you gotta see it today.
I will go see it. But one of the things that I would like to say about NWA as a group, I remember back in the '80s when that group came out, there was almost immediate change across the country in regards to in-house community and how it changed. Now, whether you take some of the positives and negatives out of the group, I think there's both there. I do think that there were a lot of things that changed. And I grew up in St. Louis, Missouri. A lot of things that changed in-house that were not so good. that the NWA was kind of like the bridge or the bridge that a lot of negative gangs and there were other songs that they had, misogynistic songs that they had come out, that because of a lot of the things that was going on internally in our community, and all, again, going back down to the breakdown of the family, those things spread like wildfire. Mm-hmm. And overnight, you had, what was really a West Coast, Bloods and Crips and this, that, and other. A lot of that stuff just spread across the country, like, overnight. And so I think...
But don't forget, colors. See, that's the other part about it.
Yeah.
See, NWA getting a lot of blame for stuff that cinema put out there without NWA. NWA didn't have no part to do with colors. I was in Compton the year Colors came out. And it was exactly like the movie. I remember going places in the Midwest and people talk about, man, that stuff ain't real. I said, man, have you ever seen Red Water before? They said, no. I said, well, I have. I saw it right in Compton, a place where they were killing brothers, throwing them in a pond. That's real.
But Drew is just speaking to the influence of
I understand
NWA
that.
And
but,
what it did. Just
no, no,
speaking
I understand,
of,
no, no, I understand
not
that.
Not blaming everything
no,
on
no,
NWA.
No, I understand that, but I think the spreading of all of that started with the movie Colors. Because if you think, go back to NWA, they never said anything about Bloods and Crips that they were promoting any. And if you listen to the CD, they say you're now witnessing the birth of street knowledge. They never said that they were gangster rappers. See, they never said they were gangster rappers. That was the media who called them gangster rappers. They didn't own...
It's not really what you say, it's the image that you portray.
Okay, so we talk about that. I'm gonna let you get in before I talk about the image of what we're portraying.
Okay.
Well, first of all, there's always an attempt to, when we're doing something positive, you look at how hip-hop sprang up. It started off very positive. Mm-hmm. It started off uplifting. It started off as a cultural expression, a positive cultural expression. There were some at the top who saw the influence of hip-hop, who wanted to kind of divert that influence, because as long as there's drama, there's division, there's strife, there's violence in our community, it keeps us distracted from worldly affairs. That's one of the reasons why they attacked Martin Luther King, because he went from dealing with our local issues in our community to going after the government about the Vietnam War. He went from local to global. Hip-hop right now is a global voice. But what type of image did they want portrayed that it has grown globally? Speaking of Public Enemy, when they came out with It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back, and you're listening on the tape, I can't say CD now, but we'll go back to the cassette tape. When you're listening on the cassette tape back in the day, and you're hearing some of the segments on the tape as a live concert from London, as a young black male growing up in a black neighborhood, to hear that these brothers got thousands of people in London coming to hear their music, that kind of blew my mind. Mm-hmm. That's kind of when hip hop really started taking off to become that global voice. So now that it's reached a global level, oh, they got to dirty the image of this. Because they always wanted us portrayed in a negative way. Some of our immigrant brothers and sisters that come from Africa, they're told, not all of them, but I've heard a lot of stories where they are told how to look at us. How, you know, they're given a debriefing on, you know, stay away from these over here. You know, get with your community, but leave these alone because, you know, you really don't want to be around them. And, you know, all of the things that they would say that time won't permit. Now, as far as the rise of what is called gangster rap, that was a decision at the top. Mm. I can't really say that it was a, I believe these brothers had good intentions, but we all know in the music industry, there's a lot of MCs who are told, you know, that sounds good, but we don't think the people will listen to that. But if you talk about this, oh, that's what the people are listening to. These who control the radio stations, these who control distribution, these who control the record labels, they've told artists that people don't want that, they want this. But it's what gave birth to hip hop is what they were talking about in the beginning. Positivity, uplifting the community. So that's something we always have to take in consideration. Gangster rap was by design, and it wasn't by those who were spitting the lyrics.
So I just want to close it out by saying this, because you brought up a great point about image and being in control of your image. I want to say that one thing that I fear now is that we care too much about how other people perceive us, our image. Mm-hmm. And our perception of our image is, we're worried about so many other people, and I think that's what the movie showed me of a time where we did not care. We don't care if you call us thugs. We don't care what you think about us, because we know we're intelligent. We don't have to dress how you dress to tell us that we're intelligent. We don't have to eat the same foods that you eat to say that we're intelligent. We don't even have to speak how you speak to say we're intelligent. I think what happened along the way is we started looking for reasons to point the blame at one another. And I can't blame NWA for the conditions that our community was in. You can go talk to Freeway Rick and he can tell you who gave him the drug to put it inside of Compton, California. So that's not a conversation we're willing to have. We can talk about NWA, but we can't say that Ice Cube does not have some of the most prolific records discussing the ills of the black community. So he's a part of that NWA tree. He's part of the main writers of the group when they were doing that. You can see what happened once he stepped away. That's when they started talking about non-political things. That's when the tone of the group changed. Very important to bring that up and bring that to the table. My last piece on image. If you want to control image, you have to support those products or the things that you produce. If you're not going to do that, then you're just biting yourself. And you're just pretty much chopping yourself off at the legs. You can be critical while you support. Like you saw the movie, right? Mm-hmm. But you're still critical, and that's fine. But we need to support these films, and we don't need a bunch of Facebook memes, a bunch of blogs, a bunch of posts talking about how it made your life bad. No, that was Ronald Reagan. That was Reaganomics. That was the Iran-Contra War that allowed them to bring crack cocaine in the ghettos. It's going to be other movies like that that's going to follow. We just had American Gangster, which ushered in heroin into our communities. See, are we going to blame Jay-Z for rapping on the soundtrack? Or are we going to talk about the fact that, hey, under President Bush, when they invaded Afghanistan and they took out the Taliban and let the warlords who were growing the poppy seed in charge, now that heroin is flooding our streets again? Something that we didn't see since the 70s and early 80s. So sure, we have to talk about the images, true, but we also need to talk about the people who are the cause of the images. Because what we do in this country, we are just reacting to white supremacy racism. If they never brought us here in the first place, man, we wouldn't be reacting to anything. It wouldn't be no NWA, wouldn't be no Malcolm, wouldn't be no Martin.
No, I agree with you on that, Thomas. And I think that's the piece that we have to make sure we understand what the movie medium is. It's a tool to be able to have those conversations. And portraying those images are very important. We need to portray images that talk about the deeper structural pieces of how Reaganomics influenced the African-American community, led wars on drugs, started this whole reformation of education, and just kind of set a chain effect on what we're dealing with. And police.
And police.
And really amped up the militarization of law enforcement from the late, early 80s into what we're seeing now. But we can't also separate what movies have and the impact and the images of music and the images that we portray from our music has on our psyche. Because we got to keep in mind that old adage said kids don't necessarily follow what we say, they follow what we do.
That's right.
The image that we're portraying to them when it comes to our broader community, we have to be responsible for with having those discussions around those images. So that way, if we're gonna use Straight Outta Compton as a vehicle in our classrooms or community discussions, we have to chop those images up. So that way our children are not buying it and said, that's what Ice Cube really did, that's what Dr. Dre really did. No, that's a recreative image. And I think my only critique on that, well, not my only, but one of my critiques on that is that they had control over that. So we're not talking about Paramount or Disney or somebody taking their story and trying to recreate it. They, Cube Vision had an influence on that. And what is his obligation of being able to portray accurate images of what really happened to our community? I'm not concerned about what white institutions, white supremacies, and people in bigger oligarchies have to say on us. I'm talking about our conversation amongst our own people and the images that we're willing to give to one another, whether it's for real social and intellectual upliftment or for entertainment value. Are we gonna keep selling ourselves out for a ticket?
True, but you gotta look at it. It's his truth, her truth, and the truth.
And the truth.
So Cube got a chance to tell his truth. D. Barnes is telling her truth.
That's right.
Then it's the actual truth that we'll never see on film, we'll never read on a blog, we'll never see on a Facebook post, because it's everyone's personal opinion.
Yeah.
So that's the whole thing, and that's what we gotta look at. Even though it's a biopic, supposedly
yeah,
right?
Mm-hmm.
It's still, at the end of the day, it's a matter of opinion.
Somebody's opinion.
So it's not fact.
That's true.
Well, I think the thing that you mentioned earlier about when you're dealing with, how did you say it? I don't want to misquote you. Oh man, I'm sorry, it escapes me. But the one thing that I do want to say is this: when you talk about image, even these interviews that are coming up lately, who's giving them a voice to even have these interviews? Is it Dr. Dre? Is it Ice Cube? Who is it that's pulling them out of the woodworks and giving them a public platform? Say what you got to say to millions of Americans about how you feel about the situation. And that's the thing that, you know, anytime we're doing something positive, they want to try to find some way to discredit it or to smudge it. You know, to draw the attention away from the good of the situation. Because one thing we all have to be real about is none of us are perfect. None of us.
Right.
And one thing that I've learned being a student of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, he says anytime you're dealing with people, and we talk about judging people, right? So you really can't judge somebody until there's a period to their testament. As long as they're still writing their story, you can't give a fair assessment because we change. I'm a different person than what I was 5 minutes ago, let alone 5 weeks ago, 5 months ago, 5 years ago. We're constantly evolving as an individual. So as we're on this evolutionary process, our mind change, our opinions change, our level of understanding changes. So to try to judge a situation, you know, it's really unjust until, you know, that person is dead and gone. Then you have a total assessment of their life, and now you can say, oh, okay, here's what I like about them and here's what I don't like about them. But when something's in transition, as we all are in transition, you know, it's really hard to put an assessment like that. So here it is, you have a movie that was put out by our brother telling their story. And anytime anybody does something, we always have to look at the motives. And we know one of the motives is them telling their story. But I think some of the things that they highlighted in the movie is also congruent with the time that we're in. And where did the spirit of F the Police come from anyway? See, I never knew the backdrop of that from the incidents that took place in their personal life. I mean, we all have a story to tell with negative encounters with law enforcement, but they just got into a situation right outside the studio.
Which I challenge the accuracy on that.
Well, it may be true, it may be not, but we do know they did have interactions in their neighborhood. The way the movie's portraying it is like it just happened and then they went into the studio. But in either case, these are life experiences and they said, you know what, I'm tired of this. You know, so they put it out there. Then we got our first recording with the Rodney King situation. Now, it didn't just affect us in America, but you have people in Africa talking about Rodney King. That broadcasted all over the world. So the world got a chance to see. While you have American media and American entertainment industry trying to portray a certain image of us, the world got a chance to see how they're treating us. And could the way that we're acting, could it be a side effect of the mistreatment and the injustices that we have suffered as a people? You can't do what you've done to us and expect us to come out looking like the perfect angel. They've done everything in their power to destroy us.
And can we stop right there so we can get to the next segment?
Absolutely.
I am Olutimi Lehan, and I'm introducing the final segment today. And we're going to discuss our closing arguments, our closing opinions on the subject matter we discussed already. We really want to touch on the justice or else march that's taking place. We're blessed to have the panel that we have here. And Brother Antonio, if you could just tell us, for those of us that don't know about the march, for those of us that do, there are misconceptions out there, there's a comparison to the first march. Expound on it, brother.
Thank you, brother. Well, first of all, the first march, the whole reason the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan called us to Washington, D.C., was for black men to be more responsible. You know, the theme of the march was atonement, reconciliation, and responsibility. So we have issues in our community where men aren't being the providers they need to be. They're not being responsible human beings. They're not being the fathers to their children. They're not being productive members of society. Not all of us, of course, but some of us. But even those of us who are doing some good, we can all do better. So what the minister was doing was bringing all of us to Washington, D.C., for one, that we could stand before our Creator and atone for our Creator for the wrong that we have done, and that we can atone with one another as brothers. So the end result of the march is, despite all of the opposition of the march, we still had close to 2 million black men show up. And from those 2 million black men that went back home to their communities, as Minister Farrakhan asked us, as we were leaving, he told all of us to join some type of church, join some type of mosque, join some type of organization that's working in your community. You know, get involved in politics, look after the orphans, look after those who are in foster care, those who need to be adopted. And there was a major increase in adoption, a major increase in foster care. The NAACP, the Urban League, their membership skyrocketed after the march. Over 1 million black men got registered to vote. And crime dropped all over America. Now, Clinton tried to take credit for that. But come on now, when has any president of the United Snakes of America being able to take credit for the good that is happening in our communities?
To make a double negative, not never. Right, if you could juxtapose what's going on with this new march in comparison to the first one. Is there a difference in ideology with the second march?
Absolutely. With everything that we've been going through for the last 460 years, you consider every movement, every demonstration, every march, every protest that we have done, it has yielded little to no results. Not that our efforts are in the right spirit, but as far as the effect that it has had with our oppressor, with getting an answer to our problems, with getting our issues resolved. You know, for the most part, some of our activity is like spinning on hamster wheels. You know, we're making moves, we're making motion, we're doing things, but it's not yielding the results that we really need. And part of the reason is because those who are a part of the problem, we're going to them to help resolve our solutions. And what I mean by that is this: he who pays the piper calls the tune. You can't really give a strong voice on what's going on in your community if you're asking your oppressor to finance your movement.
Fair enough.
One thing that's separated the Million Man March from the other movements is we didn't have white philanthropic dollars donating our march. We paid our own way. We paid our own way. We had brothers all over the country giving $10, $15, $20, $50. We didn't do it on a weekend. We did it on a Monday, which never happened in history before. So you have almost 2 million black men showing up in D.C. on a weekday where they didn't go to work, they didn't go to school, and they paid their own way. Now, all the other marches in history, and not to take anything away from the other marches, that's not what I'm saying here, because I believe in the intentions of our people when we go do demonstrations, because we're fighting for justice. But you look at in the 40s, the cry was jobs, justice. In the 50s, the cry was jobs, justice. The 60s, the cry was jobs, justice. The 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the year 2000. Here we are in 2015, and we're still crying for jobs and justice. Obviously, what we've done thus far has not worked. And the reason being is because there's no consequence for the actions of our oppressor. So Minister Farrakhan, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, is taking us back to DC, and he's letting them know this time around, it's justice or else. Because we've tried everything else that you can imagine. We've sat in, we've laid in, we've stood in the middle of highways, we've protested, we've picketed, we've tried everything. There's nothing else left for us to do. What are you trying to force our hands? If we're going to be men and fight for ourselves to defend our community, it's about that time.
Okay.
It's about that time.
You know, your brothers want to chime in about how you feel about it, your thought process going forward?
Yeah, I'm interested in definitely seeing how, you know, what type of solutions or what type of things comes out of this Million Man March. It's not, you know, the other Million Man Marches that have existed before, I've never been a part of most of them. I think I was younger and I really didn't, you know, have any guidance to lead me to say, okay, well, this is something that you should be involved in. So at this point, when I have a family and I have, you know, two young boys growing up in my home and a young lady, then now I'm much more invested into my community. So I'm interested in seeing, you know, what can come about and what some of the changes are can be created out of this march. So I'm definitely intrigued and moving forward with this march.
All right, Brother Javon.
Definitely interested in, you know, the possibilities that could come from just us all uniting on one accord, you mm-hmm. know, to build and to demand justice. I think it's important for us as men especially, but to see, you know, whatever comes out of this, who speaks and how we galvanize after this, because that's more important. Like the thing is the solution, and how are we going to come to that solution? And so, you know, I think that impacts us all, and it's important for us all.
Absolutely. You know, one thing Minister Farrakhan has said, worth referencing, we spoke on this a little bit earlier about Martin Luther King's last speech when he was dealing with the strikers, the garbage men in Memphis, about redistributing the pain. That's one thing that we intend to do. When we state our case, and we're not begging, we're not asking, we're demanding. This is an ultimatum. We're not going there crawling. We're going to stand as men, as he has asked for 10,000 fearless in our community to come and represent us, just in case, one aspect of the or else, whatever they may be. You know, but the thing is, if we're going to stand as men and we're going to redistribute the pain, Dr. King was saying in his last speech about not supporting some of their businesses, you know, pulling our dollars back in our community. So two of the things that are on the agenda, I won't say it all now because I won't go ahead of our minister, but two of the things that are on the agenda is we will campaign nationwide to boycott Black Friday. Withdraw the black dollar from Black Friday, because Black Friday, Thanksgiving, Christmas, even though some of these things were celebrated, they didn't make it a national holiday until they deemed that it was a possibility of how they could boost their economy at the end of the year. As the year closes out and they need more dollars to circulate in their economy, that's when they made it law. There's really no divine purpose for it. So we're going to boycott Black Friday. We're going to have a nationwide boycott, and we don't want to take our people away from celebrating Christmas. But if you are a Christian, let December 25th be about Christ. Don't let it be about Santa Claus, because how many millions and billions of dollars do we give to these people who don't like us and they don't even love Jesus? So.
All right, Clay, this is our second Brothers Build. From our left to right, we have
Brother Antonio Muhammad,
Andrew Lemmy,
Jovan Amani.
And I'm Olatimele Nolasanya. This is our second Brother Bill. We broached three very important topics. I feel blessed to be here in the presence of the people that I've been here with. I hope that those of us that get a chance to view this truly enjoy it and learn something from it. Had an amazing time. Look forward to the next one. Peace. We'll be right back.